Knowing your rights as a consumer is as important as acting on them. So today we talk about how educating yourself as a consumer could protect you not just from substandard service, but from scams and how it could also save you money. I'm Edric Mendoza and this is On The Money. Joining us on the show today is Mr. Jose P. Pepito, president of the Nationwide Association of Consumers, Inc., NACI, and chairman of the National Consumer Affairs Council, or NCAC. Welcome to the show, Mr. Pepito.
Welcome.
Yeah, thank you for being here.
It's a pleasure.
Yeah, so, you know, a lot of people have concerns as consumers, so I'm very excited to find out
so.
What you can share with us. Yeah. No? So tell me, between the two, how do they help consumers today?
NACI was organized independent of NCAC.
Okay.
This was organized in order to fight pyramiding. This was our initial concerns.
Okay.
And then later on, we had to branch out into other consumer concerns. Mm-hmm. And then this is when we coordinated with DTI, and this is where we got the knowledge of NCAC.
I see.
That's right. We cooperated with DTI and mm-hmm. then through NCAC.
I see. And what exactly do you do for consumers? What do these organizations do?
What we did was to represent consumers in the crafting of rules, regulations, even laws mm-hmm. that affects consumers, like...
To protect them, no?
Yes,
like
of
in
course.
The pyramiding case, which you mentioned earlier. Okay.
In Congress, for example, mm-hmm. if there is a bill that is being proposed which affects consumers, then mm-hmm. we go there and represent the consumers in public hearings. And then with DTI and with DA, for example, mm-hmm. if they craft some policies, rules, mm-hmm. regulations affecting consumers, we are also invited and to air the side of consumers regarding these rules and regulations.
Wonderful. Once again, to protect the consumers.
Yes.
No. Okay. Now, were you also instrumental in creating the 8 consumer rights that we have?
No. Actually, 8 consumer rights, may history yan eh.
Okay.
4 of these 8 consumers were initially enunciated by the late U.S. President John F. Kennedy.
Okay.
4. And then the other 4 were added to make it 8 by Consumer International. This is again
another group altogether.
Organization of international coverage.
Mm-hmm.
So that made it 8, and now it is 8. The
4
that JFK initiated mm-hmm. first was the right to safety.
Okay.
The right to information,
mm-hmm.
the right to choose, and the right to redress.
Okay, maybe 4. We can go through a little bit each of them. So the right to safety, what is that?
The right to safety is the right of of consumers to be provided with safe goods and services.
Sure. Not poisonous food
or
harmful products that can hurt their children, things like that.
Especially toys, for example. There should not be any sharp object within the toys.
Mm-hmm.
And then the recent controversy about paints used in toys.
Toxic paints. Okay.
So that violates this right.
Okay. How about, let's talk about the right to choose. That's the other
the
one.
The right to
right?
choose, because consumers should be given the right to choose, meaning they should not be bamboozled into buying something just because it is offered to them, but there should be a lot of similar items so that consumers can choose which he thinks is fit.
Okay.
So
is it the presence of options or the absence of coercion? Because if coercion is, bilhin mo na to, buy this, I don't have a right to choose.
It should be both.
Both.
It should
okay.
be both. The absence of coercion.
The
consumer should not be coerced to buy something which he may not need at all or which may not fit into his needs.
Okay.
The right to information, right?
Yes, the right to information.
Yeah, the right to information. This is especially true when you buy medicines.
Okay.
There should be in the label mm-hmm. information like basically the information about expiry. It should be in the label so that people can look at it and say,
it's
expired, which may not be effective anymore.
Right.
So it should, the information should be in the label itself, mm-hmm. okay? And especially information technical skin, what is in the medicine mm-hmm. must be
actually inside the content
in the label.
Itself.
What okay. is inside must mm-hmm. be placed in the label. Okay. Not only what is inside, but what is the strengths
right.
of the elements inside.
Right. Okay, so Mr. Pepito, we know about the four of GFK. The balance four that you said that the international organization yeah. was able to craft, can you just enumerate those four?
The first, we should consider the first year, as far as we're concerned, is the right to basic needs. Okay. The right to basic needs, where mm-hmm. the consumer should be assured of the supply of the basic needs.
Sure.
Okay. Then we have mentioned the right to safety, the right to representation.
Okay. Right to representation. What's the third?
We should be represented, mm-hmm. and then the right to
redress.
Yeah. Consumer education.
Okay. Consumer
they have
education.
To be educated.
Right.
To be provided with proper knowledge about consumer rights.
Okay.
Okay. The last is the right to a healthy environment. Like especially the right to information, mm-hmm. they should know before buying. They should know what they're buying, and they will usually know this in the label of the product that they intend to buy. Mm-hmm. And then, as I said, I'll go back to medicines. You may buy something that has already expired, mm-hmm. and you will only learn it when you reach home and they started right. reading it at home.
Right.
But you have it already.
Okay. So my question is,
you lose money.
Exactly. In that example, a person finds out, can they go back since it's their right to information and they were not informed? Can they now go back to the store and say, it's my right. You did not inform me. Give me my money back. Is that something that they can do? Yeah.
As far as the consumers, they can go back, mm-hmm. but the problem is, mm-hmm. If the consumer, Filipino consumers are a passive lot, you know.
Yes, that is so true. Mahiyain, they don't want to confront.
Gagastos na naman ako papunta doon.
Kaya nga, sayang lang. But if they knew this and it was substantial,
yeah, that's right.
You're saying as a consumer, right, they should
can.
Be able to.
Yes, they should be able
not
to go
can,
back
but they
and
should.
Then oh. present it.
Okay.
Of course, with the receipt.
Okay.
That's another problem because Filipinos usually throw away receipts.
Okay. My next question would be, I understand there are also responsibilities.
Yes,
can
course.
You walk us through the responsibilities of a consumer? Yeah.
There are five mm-hmm. responsibilities.
You could enumerate those.
Yeah, these are the... First is critical awareness.
Yeah.
Critical awareness. Mm-hmm. Meaning, consumers should be aware of what they want to buy, and then what are the things that are available mm-hmm. for in the market mm-hmm. for consumers, and be aware of whether or not these are good or bad. So, and so that if it is bad, they should do something. That's mm-hmm. where the consumer responsibility number two is action.
Action.
Mm. You have to do something in order to correct. What you have seen
as expired product, go to the store.
Yeah.
Okay. Excellent. What else?
Mm-hmm. And then we have the next is the social concern. Mm-hmm. Meaning, go back to that rice again. You have to be sure that you do not waste, because what you waste probably is what other people need.
Could actually use okay? and utilize. Very
then
good. Okay. Number four.
Environmental awareness. Mm-hmm. This is where the use of plastic again come over. Mm-hmm. You know that plastic is not good. Mm-hmm. I mean, it harms our environment. Mm-hmm. So, environment awareness.
It's your duty to know these
it is
things.
Your duty mm-hmm. to help
Excellent.
Preserve our environment.
And
the fifth is solidarity.
Okay, what is that?
Meaning that to be more effective, mm-hmm. you should involve yourself with organized consumer groups so that you will have.
Such
bigger
as,
voice.
Yeah.
If they're interested, they can go to NCAC and get copies. We have copies of this.
The
we
council.
Have we have some people who came to us to mm-hmm. help, to ask our help. Mm-hmm. But usually these mm-hmm. people do this when they do not get any action from other
anyone
people.
Else. Right. Okay.
TV, for mm-hmm. example, he had a problem because it did not function well. They send the technicians to his house,
right.
to be charged every time he visits.
Wow, that's not right. So that's not right. Okay.
So
he came to you.
He complained to the company. He did not get any
response, any
response,
feedback. So he went
and,
to you.
So he came to us, and then what we did was just to endorse it to the proper authority, which is NTC.
Right. And did he get his?
And then he got his money back.
That deserves this is a great topic. We're gonna have questions from our viewers now, Mr. Pepito. In the meantime, we have to pause for a short break. Stay tuned. On the Money, we'll be right back. Welcome back to On the Money. Let's check what Salve Dublito has for us in Salve Says.
It's time for a quick reminder about gift checks and gift cards that you might have received over the holidays. The Department of Trade and Industry has issued new rules in 2010 that prohibits companies to put an expiration date on gift checks and gift cards. These took effect on July 2012. Gift checks and cards issued before July 2012 may still have expiration dates, so you have to check whether the ones you're holding will soon expire.
For those that were issued before July 1, last year we kept on announcing it on radio and also reminding the public, use it as it expires, okay, because it cannot be extended. It cannot be extended. Unless, well, sometimes out of goodwill, some stores, as long as they can prove that what you are presenting to them is still the genuine or the authentic one, they sometimes give a little extension. Maybe reason, like maybe you said you misplaced it, unfortunately you thought it was lost, and then they sometimes allow it, but they just give a small window for that, about 2 months most.
Now, if you've received gift checks issued after July 2012 that still have expiration dates, you should contact the DTI.
They can file a complaint, they can call, they can inform us, and we will make the necessary formal charge against whoever issued that gift check. It doesn't have to be, as long as a consumer will give us the information and we'll do the complaining, because in the Consumer Act, it's really required that there should be a consumer complainant.
Part of your right as a consumer is the right to exchange, get a repair or a refund on items that you can't use because of defects, and that includes gifts.
That is not allowed by law, but this is, and that anyone who buys a product that is found defective, hidden defects, maybe we just have to be clear about that. If you buy a product and you find out later after you've started using it, that a defect is coming out of the product, or it is not actually providing you the service that you bought it for, then you can go back to the store, complain about it. They can either either ask them to repair it. If you're not satisfied, get a refund for it or a replacement. They believe that they should be given the chance first to have it repaired. Okay. Now, if the consumer keeps on going back for the same defect, the consumer should have the right to already demand and insist that he asks for a refund or a replacement of the product that he bought.
Again, be watchful about your money. Nobody else will do it for you.
You should get what you pay for. Complaining or commending as a consumer benefits everyone, you and the business industry as a whole.
Still with us is Mr. Jose Pepito, President of the Nationwide Association of Consumers, Inc., or NACI, and Chairman of the National Consumer Affairs Council, or NCAC. And of course, with us is Melissa Hecoleo with your money questions. Mel.
Hi, Edric. Hello, Mr. Pepito.
Hi. Yeah.
Before we start, I want you to tell me that story about the case of the disappearing load.
Okay.
It sounds so interesting.
Yeah.
I'm here. I'm on edge. Okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Actually, This started with Senator Enrile, remember? Mm-hmm. And he conducted a Senate hearing on the disappearing.
I remember that. Okay.
So I was there. Mm-hmm. I attended because I said I am a victim, so I would like to attend the hearing.
Yeah, okay.
So I registered my complaint there with the NTC. I learned that they have they have an office there called One Stop Public Assistance Center, OSPAC.
Okay.
One Stop Public Assistance Center, who actually complained expeditiously. I did not tell them myself. Mm-hmm. I just said that I have a complaint like this. And so I emailed them. Mm-hmm. And they endorsed this complaint to Globe. And in 2 weeks' time, I got my refund. I enumerated the instances where I just bought 300 pesos worth of float, and then in 1 week time, it was empty.
Okay.
That I enumerated my use of the load. So I said, how can the 300
suddenly disappear
with only this kind of use?
Yeah.
So that's a case where you can get your money back as a consumer for faulty service.
Yes.
Now, what are the proper steps to take when you make a complaint?
Well, because I knew it was OSPAC was the one who was going to act on it, mm-hmm. so I communicated directly with OSPAC. But
right.
Many people would not know about NTC, about OSPAC, mm-hmm. so mm-hmm. but they know about, they're aware of DTI. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So probably they can address it through DTI, and DTI will be the ones who will forward this
complaint. But when you make a complaint, you have to very clearly outline what you are looking for?
Yes, of course. Okay. What is important in the complaint is you have to enumerate or to tell in your complaint exactly what happened. Mm-hmm. And then an important thing is that you should include in that complaint letter what you want to mm-hmm. be done.
I see, the action complaint. Point.
The action
okay.
point, yes. You have to tell them what you want.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Otherwise, they will just say, okay, there is a complaint, they will just file it probably.
Right.
But if you want a particular action to be done, then they will have to.
Is it possible, some service providers maybe don't provide such stellar service? Lots of dropped calls,
That's right.
lots
That's
of
right.
texts never received. This can result in money loss.
Sure, yeah,
if it
makes
is
sense.
Something important to do with business,
I
right?
I heard last night, I think, was it last night or the other night, the director of NTC, Director Cabarrios, was being interviewed, and they said they are now watching the telcos because of these complaints.
I am so happy to hear that. So
yeah.
does that mean that you can make a complaint about bad service
course,
and
yes,
get your money
course.
Back?
You put it in your complaint that you are, this is the amount that
I have lost
I have
as
lost
a result of drop calls.
Of drop calls.
Interesting.
Okay.
Yeah, so that they will know that how much you lost.
Okay,
and
I
then
see.
Probably
you can find it, yeah.
Yeah.
I see. Okay, I also understand your group educates people on identifying the differences between pyramid schemes and legitimate networking.
We teach them the difference between pyramiding and networking. Mm-hmm. Because our group is supports and believes in networking. Mm-hmm. Networking is the only system which allows people to be part of a big business without having to invest so much
mm-hmm.
money.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Just the entry fee of so many hundreds or probably 1,000 mm-hmm. pesos, and then you are already part of the business. And then you can grow through the technology. Mm-hmm. And you do not have to organize an office. You do not have to have an accountant. Mm-hmm. You do not have to have a secretary because the company does it for
sure.
you.
Sure, mm-hmm. sure.
See?
Yeah.
So how do you identify a legitimate networking business from a pyramiding scam?
When we started our training, at that time, there was one basic difference between networking and pyramiding. and this is the absence of products. When a scheme gives you money without
any product
to sell,
right,
then you should be immediately doubt to it.
Right.
Yes.
Because a marketing company always has products to sell, and you earn because of selling products.
That's right. Mm-hmm. That makes sense.
Without any product, how can you earn? Where does the money come from? See. So that is the one of the main difference even until now. But then this is commerce, you know, they became sophisticated also. They started introducing products. Okay, but the difference is the product that they offer, one, either the fee that they are asking, they will ask you, is very much more than the cost of the products that they give you. Like, for example, there was this company that I know of asks you for 8,000 pesos entry fee.
And
then
the
you get
plus.
Goods. Then you compute the value of the goods. It is only up to 5,000. Mm. So where does the 3,000 pesos go?
Scam, right?
See?
There you go.
It
that's
goes
the
up.
Indicator, yep.
It goes up. Mm-hmm. This is what your recruiter earns for recruiting you. See? And that will qualify it as pyramiding.
Okay, because they are not making money from profit from the business, but from the person they have recruited.
From the profit of a legitimate business.
Product.
Okay.
But it is the money comes from the money that is being invested by the recruit.
Okay. So that's how the right to education can really help you save money, protect yourself.
Mm-hmm. Ask. Educate yourself. Yeah.
Ask. They give you money, you ask, where did it come from? Where does it come from?
Makes sense.
Correct. Okay, now we have a question from one of our viewers. Michael Allen Dongson via Facebook asks, we were at the SM Hypermart the other day. We went to the food court with my 70-year-old dad and bought a pizza and a roasted chicken at the rotisserie. At the pizza stand, his senior citizen card was immediately honored. Mm-hmm. But for the roast chicken, they asked for a booklet for food, similar to the booklet for drugs. My dad complained, and the cashier even had to talk to a supervisor. We were finally given a discount, but informed that it was only 5% instead of the 20%, and it was only limited to 600 pesos per week. Is there a law mandating this regarding food service for senior citizens?
No. The 5% discount is for groceries. Mm-hmm. But this is food.
Yeah.
This is cooked chicken. So this is not your grocery item. The law says food for the senior citizen is subject to
12%
12% VAT, less 20% senior citizen discount.
So that's 32%.
That's 32%.
Yes,
because the senior citizens are VAT exempt.
Mm-hmm,
purchases
that's right.
of senior citizens is VAT exempt. So less 12, less 20.
So can he now complain?
Yes, of course.
Okay.
Yeah, of course.
So he could go to the DTI or he could go to your group and complain.
Mm-hmm. And we can endorse it to DTI. Anyway, I would like also to remind the public that the senior citizen discount is only for the senior citizens.
Yes.
In case
mm-hmm.
you go to a store and then or to a restaurant, for example, in a group, the discount, the senior citizen discount, is not for the entire group,
it's
but
only for the portion.
For the
yes,
that's right.
Of course. Okay, now Ara asks, how can I stay regularly updated on my consumer rights?
All she has to do is to get a copy of the booklet. She can, this booklet, for example, mm-hmm. she mm-hmm. can go to the DTI and to NCAC office
in
at DTI building mm-hmm. at the ground floor, and then ask for a copy.
It is free.
It is free.
Excellent.
We're giving this out. It's free.
Excellent.
So, can knowing your rights and acting on them really save you a lot of money?
Yeah, of course. It does. Mm-hmm. It does. Because you will be able to, you will get the benefits of that is due to consumers.
Sure.
Rather than be ignorant all about it and then get shoddy products, for example.
Right.
And I think it also helps vendors stay on their toes. Yes. To make sure they give good quality. Do you agree, Mr. Pepito?
Yes. And I think we as consumers serve as a check.
Exactly.
To those businesses.
Remember, the consumer rights applies to product, service, and credit.
Credit, okay. So in the sense, when you talk about credit.
Yeah, if you are being charged, although now I think as far as loans are concerned, the interest is not anymore regulated. But just the same, even if it is not regulated, if you charge so much,
exorbitant rates,
BSP will go right after you.
Okay, so if you think that you were being given a loan at too high a rate,
you
can go to the BSP and say, look, I don't think this is right.
There is the BSP has already an office there which acts on which look after consumer welfare.
That is great to know.
Yeah, okay. They have already.
Okay, good. Yeah, that's good for investors too, actually.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, now Ron asks, do I have to have a backer if I file a complaint against a business? I feel like if I just make a complaint, nothing will happen.
No, you don't have to. You don't have to have that.
Okay.
All you do is file a complaint.
Right.
And then, of course, you follow it up, because sometimes complaints can be left unattended, and then because some people forget, or else there are a lot of complaints, and then they file up one after the other over your complaint, and so you follow up.
Okay. NCAI is sort of a backer. Since it's a consumer organization, they can go to you and
help
support them?
Yes, probably, because we endorse your complaints.
There you go.
Okay.
That carries, help expedite things.
That carries the name of
of your organization.
Yeah, sure. Right.
Send us your money questions via email, Facebook, or Twitter, and we'll try to answer them in our upcoming episodes or on our next Q&A Friday.
Information and education, I think, is very important. So thank you. It's great to see that there are booklets like that for free. So I'm going to get myself a copy. Thank you again, Mr. Pepito. Mel? That's our show today. I'm Edric Mendoza. Join us again tomorrow for more Talk and Tip so you're always right on the money.